So welcome to Ask GMBN Tech. This is the section on the channel each week where we get to answer all your mountain biking tech related questions. Don't forget you can add your questions in the comments below, and of course you can send them in to the email address on the screen right now. So first up, we've got a question from Sean Jones, and this is quite a deep one to jump straight in on. The world of bottom brackets is a minefield. Can you give me a bit of depth explaining the various types and the pros and cons of each? Okay, you ready for this? Like, there's a lot of information here, so I'm going to keep this pretty concise because I do think there's going to be quite a cool video we can do with this later on. So first up, we've got old threaded. So that was a 17 millimeter steel axle, and it had a tapered edge on the end, and the cranks would bolt onto that and you'd have a bottom bracket in the frame. All's well, but if your crank got loose, basically you would wear the end of the crank away because it's made of soft aluminium from the steel axle, and it would never correctly tighten. So it commonly happens with your left-hand crank. Also, the bearings inside weren't the best, and after a while they used to disintegrate. Shimano, in fact, in this era, provided cartridge bottom brackets. So pretty much once the bottom bracket had self-destructed, threw it away, put a new one in. Next up, you go on to the regular conventional threaded bottom bracket, which is what most mountain bikes still have these days. So that's with a 24mm steel axle. The axle is pressed into one side of the cranks, depending on the manufacturer, whether that's left or right, and you have outboard bearings. So bearings are nice and big, they're fairly well sealed, and they tend to do the job quite well. But as with all bearings in bottom brackets, the issue isn't necessarily the size or the position of bearings, it's always about where the mud and muck can get in. So bearings are going to work perfectly well to the load of what you put through them. As soon as they're dirty, they're going to destroy themselves, basically, and you will replace those bearings. That's why we always tell you not to jet wash bearings directly. So next up was BB95. So this was developed by Trek, and this was a way of using the same size axle but having the bearings pressed directly into the frame. So doing without the threaded cups that go in, so the bearings literally push into the frame. A really neat and tidy system, but the downsides of this are you had to have an extremely well-made frame to have that housed in there. Very expensive to produce, it had to be very accurate. There's a few other downsides as well. If you wanted to run a chain guide in the era when they came out, you couldn't because there wasn't a cup to screw it against the frame. Later on, we got the ISCG mounts, International Standard Chain Guide, and that helped get around that problem. So following that was press fit 86 and 92. So essentially the same system as the BB95, but instead of having the really expensive frame to push them in, they got around this by having the bearings in these little plastic sort of composite cups, and they'd push into the frame. So it made the frame a lot cheaper to produce. It didn't have a threaded bottom bracket. It didn't have the expensive bearing surfaces in there. And it works well, but installation is key. If you don't get it in right, they will creak. And they do develop creaks over time. And the whole press fit system, they're very love or hate. I don't really like them myself. I prefer standard threaded, like the way it works. Over time, you know what's gonna happen with it. BB30 was the next one that came up. It's very similar to a BB95, except it has a 30 millimeter axle that's made of aluminium. So the axle is a lot bigger, stiffer, and lighter as well than the 24 millimeter steel option. The downside is the bearings are smaller. Again, the bearings not necessarily a problem in this case, it was how they put into the frame and of course the contamination that gets to them. So now SRAM have just announced their new dub system. Now this is new crank, axle, and bottom bracket system, but a good thing about this, it doesn't require a different frame to what you already have, unlike all the other variations, you have to have a specific frame for a specific bottom bracket. So they make a system for each of the systems out there currently, BB30, regular threaded, etc. And the idea is the bearings stay in the same position no matter what bottom bracket system you have. Bearings are outboard, and you have the crank axle, 30mm axle, well actually it's 28.99mm, so just under that. And SRAM say that is so it can increase the bearing size used on them. But the thing that's really key in the whole system isn't the fact that it uses that bigger axle, it's the fact that the bearings are ultimately sealed. So SRAM have directly addressed the problem of contamination getting into those bearings. Now, we've not ridden one yet, so we can't comment on it, but it is a brand new system and you are gonna start seeing that soon. Okay, so next up, Christian Rahi asks, is it normal that the front derailleur won't shift under hard load, like going slow on a steep hill? I've got a SRAM X5 setup. Yeah, pretty much. So gear shifting shouldn't really be done under load. You should sort of minutely let up just as you change gear, just enough time for the chain to jump. So if you look at the rear derailleur, you can change under pressure a lot easier. And the reason for that is the sprocket sizes are a lot closer, so the chain doesn't have to jump as far in either direction. But you could still damage your chain and sometimes your rear mech by changing hard under pressure. With the front, you've got to bear in mind how big the jump is going from, say, the granny ring, which is a small one, up to the middle or vice versa. That's a significant jump. So if you're trying to change under load, you're actually keeping the chain on there with your torque more than the chain is trying to jump off to the next ring. So just bear that in mind and really try and make your gear shifting as smooth as possible. Next up is a bit of a suspension related one. So for Stephen Daniels, according to the internet, the RockShox Recon 32mm doesn't have a threaded top cap for putting volume spacers in. If I get a threaded RockShox 32mm cap, can I use tokens? It's the same one as on your Scout. Do you have any tokens in yours? So the fork on a bike behind me, no, actually I don't. I've ridden this bike virtually as stock. I've swapped the tires and the grips and stuff on it. Not even set it up too much. Ran it out there in Alicante. And I do want to put some volume spacers in it. So I had a look at this last night. So if you look at the pictures on screen, you're going to find a bit of a dilemma here. So the way that RockShox volume spacers fit is they normally screw onto the top cap. Now, as you can see by this top cap, it doesn't have any threads in it. But worse than that, the actual design of this fork, it's one of their more budget forks. There's a very different air tube system on the inside. It's got a big air tube that goes all the way up and the top cap pushes into that. So there's no room, even if you fitted like a top cap from a Revelation or something like that, to do that. And you can't just go and put some oil in the tube to sort of decrease the air volume either, because the way the negative spring works on this particular fork. So I'm gonna go and see a friend with a lathe and sort of machine down some nylon tubing, and I reckon we can make our own volume spacer to simulate the size of about 3 volume spacers that will push fit into that plastic top cap. Bear with me, I'll update on the Facebook page, the GMBN Tech Facebook page. I'll let you know how I get on with that. Oh, I'm loving this question here from Simon Plakner. I hear that some EWS pros, that's the Enduro World Series, use one metallic and one organic brake pad in their brakes. In theory, this should combine all the advantages without having a noisy brake. Have you guys ever heard of it? Actually, I've been meaning to try this for a long time, because you're right. So you get supreme power with the metal brakes, but they take a while to heat up to get the ultimate power. So the resin or organic pads tend to deal with that a bit better. So you could have a quieter brake. And locally where I ride, I find a lot of descents, I'm not braking enough for the brake pads to get heated up. And I do end up with squeal in wet conditions. Typically when it's a bit icy or sort of those real sort of morning dew rides. And it's nothing to do with the fact that the brakes haven't bedded in properly, it is exactly the fact that they're not heated up. So some riders do that. I haven't got a list of names for you off the top of my head, but I do know that Greg Minard did that at Cairns at the downhill last year in his brakes. He had Shimano set up with one resin pad and one metal. So it's definitely food for thought there. I'm gonna go and get a combination of both and try it myself. I'd love to hear it if you do the same. Let us know how you get on. Okay, next question is more of a maintenance related question. It's from Andy Booth MTB. Hi guys, what is the best gear inner cable to buy? I'm currently looking at Jaguar and they've got 6 different options, ranging from standard to slick galvanized, slick steel, pro polished and elite. Please help me, where do I go? Yeah, okay, so even gear inner cables can be a bit of a minefield. They all vary. First up, the basic one that's just a steel cable, I would avoid those because they're not coated in any way, they're not stainless either. So they will corrode at some point, and also they're not as high quality in the way they're wound as the other cables, so they will stretch a lot easier. Now it does depend on the style of frame you've got. If you've got one piece housing running from your mech all the way to the handlebars, in theory it's very well sealed. So as long as you install it correctly in the first place and you put a bit of light grease or some oil in there, it should run well. Of course, the more expensive cables have got a higher quality coating on them, so it does mean they're going to run slicker for longer. But really, where those cables are better is if you've got unusual cable routing on your bike. So I had a GT Force in the past, really nice bike to ride, but it had some crazy cable routing around the bottom bracket area. And as a result of that, I constantly had to change the cables until I changed the actual routing to get it right the way I wanted it. And if your bike has got unusual cable routing, you can definitely maximize on the reducing the friction by using a cable setup like that. But otherwise, just get a fairly regular cable. Stainless steel is fine as long as you install them correctly in the first place. Personally, I like to buy the big workshop reels that have got a couple of hundred of those on there, and they last me for years. In fact, I've got one I've had probably 5 or 6 years now, and I'm only just running out. So that's also a worthwhile consideration. So a good question here from Florian End relating to the YT Jeffsy I mentioned last time. So yes, it's on a 1x11 system with a 946 cassette from E13. But can you make a comparison between the E13 11-speed system and SRAM Eagle with the up to the 50 tooth? Like, how can I calculate what the difference will be? All right, so firstly, let's have a look. In fact, if I reach down here, I can bring out an Eagle one and I can bring out an E13 one. So we can have a little look at these and show you what the difference is. So for starters, Eagle cassette, 10 tooth at the bottom, 50 tooth at the top. It's one piece design, absolutely massive. Bit of a masterpiece of engineering, to be honest. And the way it installs on the bike is it literally pushes onto the XD driver body and screws on. Job done. Now the E13 is a little bit different in the fact that it's got a 9 tooth at the bottom. So this is actually so small it almost overhangs the bottom, so you can't fit it in a regular way. So what they've done is they've got a two-part design. So you've got the bottom part, which is made of steel, the upper part, which is made of aluminium. Now, the aluminium part pushes on in the same way the SRAM cassette would, and it has its own independent lock ring that goes on to hold it in place. They provide the tool for that, that secures it. Then, using a pair of chain whips that you would normally use to fit any cassette, the lower part actually slots on and guides its way on. So it's a really ingenious system. And it does mean that the common ones that you wear out, the steel ones, you can replace them separately from the rest of the cassette. But it's a really good system, but being 11 speed, it's not gonna have quite as much range as a 12 speed SRAM, obviously. But I'm just gonna run you through this. So the way they're kind of compared is the E13, so this is 946, so that's a 9, 10, 12, 14, 17, 20, 24, 28, 33, 39, and 46. And then on the SRAM, with the 1050, you've got 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 21, 24, 28, 32, 36, 42, 50. So other than the jump with 42 to 50, the SRAM is a lot smoother. So the gear changing between each one is a bit more of a seamless transition, a bit more of a jump with the E13. However, one of the cool things about the E13, having the 9 tooth on the bottom and a slightly smaller one on the top, means you can use a smaller chainring to get a fairly similar range of gears. And the advantage of that is if your bike has got long wheelbase or it's got a low bottom bracket, it gives you a bit more clearance. So you notice that a lot of riders running the SRAM Eagle are opting for bigger chainrings because of that huge 50 tooth dinner plate outer sprocket. So I've just made some calculations so we can roughly compare the E13 with a 32 tooth chainring compared to the SRAM with a 34. So this is based on a 27.5-inch wheel on both sizes with a 2.3 tyre and 170mm cranks, and you're doing 80 RPM cadence. So it's fairly average for going on the flat cranking. So in the 9-tooth sprocket on the E13, you'll be doing 23.8 miles an hour, and that gives you 100.2-inch gear. So that means for one revolution of the cranks, you will move 100.2 inches. In the 46-tooth sprocket, it's 4.7 miles an hour, and that's a 19.6-inch gear. Now with the SRAM, in the 10-tooth sprocket, you're doing 22.8 miles an hour, and it's a 95.8-inch gear. And in the 50-tooth sprocket, it's 4.6 miles an hour and 19.2-inch gear. So you see, they're fairly similar. Of course, you can chop and change your chainring size, and it's going to have different effects with different wheel sizes and crank lengths. So if you want to actually do this yourself, I'm just going to throw you to the Sheldon Brown gear calculator online. This guy is a bike tech wizard. There's barely anything this guy hasn't figured out and got online in his page. You can input all that information for yourself to suit your preferences and your bike, and you'll get a bit more of an accurate representation of what you're looking for. Check it out, it's really cool. Okay, a couple of shorter questions now. So Hernan Valverde, if I'm on the trail using a 29-inch wheel with a 29-inch inner tube, can I use a spare tube from a 27.5-inch wheel? If so, what is the recommended tire pressure? Okay, so you can use a 26-inch tube in a 29 if you really have to. You can stretch it in. You've got to bear in mind they're made of rubber. They will stretch and they will fit. I recommend people, despite what wheel size they have, to carry a 27.5-inch wheel tube. That way, it will definitely fit a 27.5, and you can downsize it to a 26, upsize to 29. It's the middle ground. It will fit all of them comfortably. And make sure you get that tube with a Presta valve as well, because if you've got to lend that tube to someone who's got a different rim, it will always fit. So a Presta valve will fit a Presta rim drilling and a Schrader rim drilling. If you have the Schrader valve, it's only going to fit the faster Schrader drilling. So as far as pressure goes, it makes no difference. It's a rubber tube, it will fit. Ideally, long term, you don't want to be running a 26-inch tube in a 29, but a 27.5 will fit all of them. Hopefully that's helpful for you. And Joe Miller asks, is it really worth fitting a dropper post to a hardtail? 100%. Obviously it does depend on your budget, but a dropper post significantly changes the way a bike rides. And I've said it before, I'd go as far as saying a dropper post has more effect on the way you ride a mountain bike than having a front suspension fork if it's a hardtail. I genuinely think you're in more control, you're lowering your center of gravity, it's just a safer and a better way to ride. And not to mention, it's a lot more fun. There's none of those moments where you come into a section, you're a bit out of control, your body weight is far too high and forwards. You can preempt stuff, you can drop it on the fly. It just means your whole ride is a bit more fun. I would totally recommend anyone to use a dropper post. Okay, so finally, another good tech question here from Jesus Zambrano. I've read in several forums that changing the travel of a fork by 10 millimeters equals 1 degree on the head angle. Is that correct? For example, I have a giant rein with a 65 degree head angle according to the original geometry with a 160 fork. I'm using a RockShox Lyric with 170. That means the head angle is slacker, but how can I measure it? Is it really 64 degrees? Okay, so that's a guideline. Yeah, it does roughly change about 1 degree. And the best way to measure that, so first you're gonna need some sort of method to measure it. So I choose to use one of these. It's a digital angle gauge, and you basically center this on a whatever surface the bike is on. So you zero it on that surface, and at whatever angle you turn this at to from there, you'll get a very accurate reading. So if I go to my phone here, there's various apps available on the App Store for doing the same sort of thing. It's not quite as accurate on a phone as a proper digital angle gauge, but you will definitely be able to get a reading. And knowing what your bike is to start with, you can certainly work out if it's a degree slacker or two using one of those apps. Now the way to measure it, so some people would measure on the stanchion tube of the fork. Now that might be accurate on something like this RockShox Recon, where the dropouts are forward of the fork, but if the dropout is in line, it's quite often that the fork is actually raked out a tiny bit, so it's not that accurate. The simple, most accurate way to do it is to remove your stem and measure on the steerer tube itself. That is the most accurate way to find out what your steering or your head angle is. So that is the end of Ask GMBN Tech for this week. Hopefully there's been some good questions in there. Please don't forget to fire your questions in. The email address is on the screen right now. And of course, add them in the comments below. I can already see them firing in. If you want some more great tech-related videos, click over here for my Instagram selfies videos. It's all about taking a really good photograph of you on your bike. Pretty helpful video. Some people love it, some people hate it. Let us know if you do. And if you want to find out about overhauling your headset, that one's for the home DIY mechanics, click right down here. As always, click on the globe to subscribe because we've got new content coming for you every single week. And if you like this video or find it helpful, give us a thumbs up.